Welcome to the Series 7 webinar of Barjeel Geojit Financial Services. And I also take this opportunity to welcome our clients from our Muscat joint venture, QBG Geojit. For the last 7 weeks, we have been doing these sessions every Saturday and talking to some of the leading fund managers from India to understand in perspective what this COVID situation is all about and what would this impact the market in the future as well. And every week we have been seeing a lot of changes that have been happening, whether it is in terms of a market recovery or whether it is a sort of a stimulus that has come in, rate cuts and other things. So the highlight of this week has been the full announcement of the 20 lakh crore stimulus by the government. And then yesterday we had the another rate cut from the Reserve Bank of India of 40 basis points. And a lot of fiscal, non-fiscal measures have all been announced. And the country is also in a sort of on a move to come out of the lockdown mode. A lot of partial withdrawal has happened. And over the next 1, 2, 3 weeks, I think there is an expectation that a fair amount of the country would be opened up. Given this in context, it is now the question is not what has happened over the past, but to see in terms of what 2020 holds for us and beyond. And for this, we had saved the best for the last. And in this regard, I'm extremely happy and delighted to have in our midst Mr. Prashant Jain, who is the Executive Director and Chief Investment Officer of HDFC Mutual Fund, one of the leading mutual funds in India, with over 3,150 billion of rupees assets in management. Mr. Prashant Jain has over 28 years of investment management experience. He holds the distinction of being the only fund manager in India and one of the few globally who have continuously managed a scheme for over 25 years. The fund, namely HDFC Balance Advantage Fund, he has been managing it for over 25 years with a CAGR of over 16%. Mr. Jain has completed his post-graduation from IIM Bangalore and he holds a degree in mechanical engineering from IIT Kanpur. Over to you, Mr. Prashant Jain. It gives me great pleasure to have you today. And for the benefit of our investors, let me also tell you that there is a Q&A box and a chat box that is available. So please put in your questions. After Mr. Prashant completes his talk, we would have a Q&A session with you. Over to you, Mr. Jain. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Krishnan. Thank you very much for this. And I thank Barjeel Geojit Securities for giving me this opportunity to share some thoughts with you. It's indeed a pleasure being on this call. And a very good morning to all of you friends. So let me straight away come or summarize what are the key issues that I would like to discuss. And then towards the end, I would be happy to answer the questions. I think there are the three issues that we are facing or we need to discuss. Is one is, of course, COVID, and more importantly, the lockdown from an economic point of view, the sharp fall in oil prices. And I think it is also relevant to discuss the restructuring of the Yes Bank, because that also has certain implications going ahead. Coming to COVID and the lockdown, I think there are two parts in which I would like to share with you the impact of this on India. One is the impact from an external perspective, and one is the impact from an internal perspective in India. On the external side, India is quite differently placed from most other emerging markets. If you look around, you will realize that most emerging markets, they are exporters of commodities like oil, metals, or they are also exporters of manufactured goods. India is neither. India is a large importer, on the other hand, of oil, and it is also surprisingly a large importer of both gold and consumer discretionary goods. Because of the sharp fall in oil prices and because of the weak economic conditions in India, to which I will come to in a moment, I think the import of gold and consumer discretionary goods would also come down quite sharply. On the flip side, the remittances, mainly from the Gulf, would go down for India. And I think our exports would also degrow given the economic situation in the rest of the world. But the good news is that on a net basis, I think India stands to gain significantly on the balance of payments on the trade deficit front. And it appears that in the current year, after almost 12, 13 years, India might achieve a trade balance or a current account surplus in the current year. I think it would also be pertinent to mention, because some people are confused, despite the improving balance of payment situation, why is the currency weak? I think two things we must note here. One, the currency is weak, much less compared to most of the emerging markets, number one. And number two, the last few months have seen a record outflow due to FII selling, both on the equities and on the fixed income markets. So I think the gains will play out over the year, but the 20 billion or slightly more of selling in the last 4 to 8 weeks, I think has indeed created some pressure on the currency. I think as we go along, the currency should stabilize. And we are also seeing some very large foreign capital transactions in India, like Jio is selling stakes. And transactions like these, I think they will result in substantial dollar inflows into the country. And I think the rupee could probably stabilize at higher levels should the oil prices remain at these levels. So I think on the external front, India is actually quite well placed in terms of foreign exchange reserves, in terms of trade deficit. And this places us in a much stronger position compared to two or three earlier occasions when India had to really bend backwards to raise dollars abroad. I don't think that is the situation here at this point of time. It's very comforting. Now, coming to the impact on the internal economy, I think that is where the real challenges are. And as you know, India is a 60% services-led economy. 40% of people find employment in services. And as you know, India is a low-income country. The share of the lower half or the bottom 50% households in the country is 15% of the GDP, 1/5. Now, this comes to a monthly average per household income of 25,000 rupees. So the bottom half of India is actually very low-income group. I think culturally what has also changed in India in last two decades is that we have moved away from a culture of strong savings to a culture of EMI or borrowed consumption. I think the easy availability of small ticket retail loans, even for buying consumer durables, has created a situation where savings rate has fallen, and therefore I think the social distress due to this is going to be significant, because the economy is disrupted. Many low-income people in the daily wage category, these very small businessmen, the very small shopkeepers, the self-employed people, I think their incomes are disrupted. And I think this will cause considerable pain to a reasonable section of the society. I think this will also lead to a significant slowdown in both consumptions and capex by the companies, the industrial capex. The profitability of several businesses will come under significant pressure, at least for the current year. And when you are faced with a situation like this, the first instinct is to postpone non-essential capex. So I think slowdown in consumption, slowdown in industrial capex, and nearly a 50% loss of economic activity for about 2 months or the period of shutdown, I think will lead to a high single digits kind of GDP contraction in the current year. That is what it looks like. And it will be the first time in last 40 years that India will face a situation like this. In all my talks, in all my meetings, I have proudly said that there has never been a year of negative GDP growth in India because of the very strong underlying structural factors. But I think from now onwards, one cannot make that statement. So indeed, it is a very, very unique situation for India in the sense that we will the economy looks like to degrow in high single digits. I think the impact on corporate profitability will in turn put more pressure on wages, and when wages go down, the consumption once again will be a casualty. I think let me also address one more point here, because there is a view that consumption will suffer only on the discretionary side and not on the staples side or the FMCG side. Well, India is a low-income country, as I just shared with you, and the definition of discretionary goods is not uniform across the different income levels. So for someone in the middle income group in India or the higher income group, who spend few hundred rupees on a bottle of deodorant or a fragrance or an expensive shampoo or ice cream or expensive chocolate or even a packet of cream biscuits is non-discretionary. But for the lower half of the country, where the average income is 25,000 rupees a month, especially in situations like these, some of these things become discretionary. So I think the impact on consumption should be fairly broad-based. And given the very traumatic experience that people without savings and without earnings will go through, I think even if income normalizes, certain habits might change and people might want to save more. Once lockdown is lifted, and if lockdown is about to be lifted, it is being lifted in parts, economic activity is resuming. Power demand has come back very smartly. I think we are up to almost 80-85% power consumption. And I think in the next few weeks, we should be going 90-95% or closer to 100% power demand. So I think the economy will open up pretty fast. But I think certain habits might change, and only time will tell us the answers to how these habits change. I think one, social distancing, how to what extent it is practiced. Airlines in India have now said that they will not leave the middle seat vacant. So I think in a way, it is telling us how difficult it is to practice social distancing all the time. So we'll have to see to what extent people avoid visiting malls, multiplexes, retail shops, or even doctors or hospitals unless it is essential. That is one thing. I think that has some implications and to which we don't have the answers today. As I said, people will try to increase savings. And third, I think is many of us have realized that life itself does not cost much. It is lifestyle which really costs. And so we are seeing, we are expecting that some people may actually adopt a simpler lifestyle, and to what extent that impacts consumption will have to be figured out as we go along. I think the next year, I think, should be a far more better year, because the high single digit degrowth, what I expect in the economy, bulk of it will be due to 50% economy being shut down in 2 months, which is about 8% of the impact. So next year, as we are likely to have 12 months of normal economic activity, on this low base of, let's say, 100 GDP last year, it is becoming 90 roughly this year. It should go to 100 just because of the 2 month impact not being there. And on top of that, if there is any normal growth, which I am sure will be there. So next year could be a year of low double digits or mid double digits kind of growth also, but most of it will be delivered due to the low base impact. I think from an investor's perspective, the current year actually is a year which we should say we would forget about, not in the sense it is because based on the current year's earnings, it would not make sense to do any valuations. If your business normally makes 100 rupees of profits, and if you lose 20% business this year, you may make zero profits. But the impact of 1 year of no profits on a business's intrinsic value is very small. So I think we should either focus on last year's profits or next year's profits to get a correct assessment of the stock markets. And that is what I am about to do now. So I think let me just go sector by sector with you some impact on how the valuations and the prospects are of different sectors, then share with you some thoughts around how the aggregate markets are valued. So I would like to divide the sectors basically in three parts, and once where impact is minimal, and even in a year like this. And these would be sectors like, let's say, utilities. There would be hardly any impact. Oil refining and marketing companies, except for the 2 month loss on volumes, life will be pretty normal. Then there would be sectors where current year is likely to be a quite a, even IT and pharma, actually the impact is quite minimal. While in IT, we do expect a single digit degrowth in profits because some customers may ask for price cuts, companies based in US and Europe. But there are some mitigating factors as well, like a slightly lower currency, saving on travel costs, no wage pressure, etc. I must also add here that the world, despite the shutdown, has continued to work extremely well. And I think that has that has enhanced the reputation of the Indian IT companies, which I am sure have played an important role in developing these technologies or helping companies continue to run in these times. I think post-COVID, the companies would also want to invest in technologies to enable work from home environments, to adopt cloud, to increase automation. So I think the demand for IT services actually goes up, but it could come at a slightly lower price point. So I think the current year is a year of small negative growth for the IT sector. Pharma again is one sector where the impact could be minimal, but some impact is expected because the surgeries for about 2 months and medication for 2 months, non-essential, would have been impacted. But by and large, I think that is one sector which should not feel any much impact. I think the most impact will be felt by the consumer discretionary sectors, especially the automobile sector. And given the low income levels and EMI-led consumption, the borrowing-led consumption, even for white goods and brown goods, I think these companies will feel the maximum impact. And these companies also have reasonably high fixed costs. So I think the impact on profitability could be quite significant. And I would not like to hazard a guess how will the automobile sector do in the current year. I think it could be more difficult than what most of us imagine. And even next year, I think would be interesting how much of the demand recovers, because automobiles are clearly discretionary. There is a significant impact on incomes. And on top of that, because of what has happened due to the restructuring of Yes Bank, the liability franchise of some small banks is being impacted. Bond markets in India have been quite difficult, because some of you may be aware, one of the local funds had to shut its schemes because they were unable to liquidate the portfolios. And I think while that problem was specific to them because of the portfolio composition, it has created a difficult environment in the Indian bond markets. And the credit funds, while overall they are very small, just about 10 billion US, but given the reasonable selling pressure over 2 weeks especially, and the less liquid bond markets in India, the credit spreads have widened quite sharply, even for AA and single A credits. And given that environment, the ability of the NBFCs to raise resources is constrained. And you might have also heard that the Reserve Bank of India has given a 3 year initially, and now they have extended it yesterday by another 3 months. So there is a 6 month moratorium for borrowers. For NBFCs, which don't have a granular or a retail deposit franchise, it could create funding ALM mismatches. While banks would support them, but I think given the difficult environment, the willingness of most NBFCs to write loans in this environment, I don't think is there. And this will also have a significant impact on the demand for consumer discretionary goods. I think there is one more challenge here, and the sharp incomes of lower income households. As I shared with you, over the last two decades, the savings rate in this income group has gone down, and a lot of consumption in India of white goods and brown goods and automobiles and two-wheelers was supported by borrowings. I think given the dislocation in income, we are expecting a spike in non-performing loans, especially in the retail unsecured segment. And that, I think, will also put considerable pressure on the NBFCs. So I think the availability of small retail loans, which was a key driver of consumption in India over last, I would say, 5 to 10 years, will be severely impacted. And that could result in a sustained slowdown in discretionary consumption for quite some time, even after the lockdown is lifted. It's hard to guess, but the impact on business and profits in the automobiles, auto ancillaries, white goods, brown goods companies, retail malls, multiplexes, small NBFCs, small banks. I think these are areas where the impact on profitability could be quite significant, and it may sustain for some time as well. I think that leaves few other sectors. One is the oil and gas, the refining sector. There, I think the impact is likely to be minimal. Cement sector, again, I think the impact will be minimal. The EPC companies, the construction companies, I think impact will be very short-lived, because basically there is a loss of business for 2 months, but these companies have reasonable order backlogs, and I think life should come down to normal once the lockdown is lifted. If you look at the markets in aggregate, India's market cap now is at 60% market cap to GDP. And this is a very interesting level. And if you go back and check over last 2, 3, 4 decades, whenever India's market cap to GDP has been at these levels, the returns over next 3 to 5 years have been extremely, extremely good. And I think this has also, typically we have touched 50-60% market cap to GDP when there was an external trigger, like in 9/11, like dot-com bubble busting, like Lehman, like pigs or tapering. And around these difficult times in the external world, the India saw large amounts of selling by FIIs, and that led to a considerable correction in the markets. And that is what we are experiencing now as well. This time is slightly different. I mean, in the sense that this time, the India's economy in the current year will really get impacted. And on the previous occasions, it was just the stock markets that corrected and not the underlying economy. For example, even in the year of Lehman crisis, we grew 5%. But I think the current environment is quite different. And that is why I said that it does not make sense to look at India's economy or markets from the current year's perspective, but rather focus on next year. And therefore, I think 60% market cap to GDP, to my mind, is quite attractive. I think what is also happening in India is that the fiscal space of the government was limited. And as you know, probably our indirect taxes, the GST rates, are running below revenue neutral rates. And government had just cut corporate taxes from 35% to 25% few quarters back. So in a way, the stimulus was already given before COVID, and in a good way. And therefore, the resources with the government are limited. And whatever resources they have, they are using it to support the very vulnerable sections of society. I think the main direction that the stimulus has taken is to guarantee loans for the SMEs. Government has come out with a 3 lakh crore or about 40 billion loans for the SMEs that will be guaranteed. That is a very decent number. It is about 15% of the outstanding SME loans. And they are also giving liquidity support to NBFCs and to so that the lower rated NBFCs get access to liquidity. But I think the direct fiscal stimulus, at least I was not expecting, because government had already cut tax rates, and I don't think we should carry much expectations around that. One more thing which is being done and which I think is good is that the interest rates in India have been cut sharply, and I think even more could be done. Lower interest rates will be good for maintaining the financial health of individuals. It lowers the borrowing cost. It encourages consumption. It makes consumption cheaper. It reduces the interest cost for companies. And also the fiscal deficit, which will go up in the current year sharply due to a loss of revenue. I think combined fiscal deficit in India should go up by 2-4% this year. I think it will also help the government. And clearly, we are facing demand challenges. So I don't think lower interest rates are likely to lead to any inflationary pressures. So I think the if you look at the prime, the short, very short end borrowing costs of AAA companies in India, it is now around 4%. It is probably a historic low. So I think over time, these very low interest rates and of course the long-term drivers of growth in India, demographics, low oil prices, low global interest rates, I think will bring back growth into India quite strongly next year. Let me mention one more opportunity that is there for India, and that is a second chance to get back into the global manufacturing supply chain. Chinese wages now are 1.5 to 2 times of Indian wages, and China has slowly lost cost competitiveness over last 1 to 2 decades. So I think factories have been shifting out of China into Vietnam, Thailand. India was not getting a large share. With an aim to attracting these investments, Indian government is offering a 15% concessional tax rate to new manufacturing units in India that are set up. I think we are optimistic around that front because the government is working quite hard to attract these investments. And apart from the low tax rates, the competitive costs, India offers the advantage of a very large local market. As you know, India is a 3 trillion economy. It's one of the top 5-6 economies in the world. I think our disadvantage still continues to be that our score in terms of ease of doing business still ranks below some of our neighboring countries. The red tape is still, while things have improved, I think it is still more than what it should be. I think concerted attempts are being made around that. And if you look at the central government has allowed the state governments to borrow extra this year. And those part of those borrowings are tied to states carrying out reforms to improve their ease of doing business rankings and certain other reforms. So I think we have seen in the past, the biggest reforms in the country have taken place in times of crisis. And I think this is an opportunity that will again not go waste in that sense. So India is making a big push to indigenize defense production. And every year the country will come out with a negative list of imports, the items which cannot be imported next year or the year after that. I think that should definitely improve local indigenous defense production, which is a very, India is one of the largest arms importers in the world. Even in the power sector, we are expecting very quick and very significant reforms. And as I mentioned to you, the extra borrowings that the center is allowing the states to undertake is tied into their carrying out certain reforms. So I think we have seen considerable, government has also talked about land and labor reforms, and let us see what is in store for us. But past experience tells us that every crisis in India has, while it has created challenges in the near term, but from a medium to long term perspective, the economy has moved ahead. And I have no doubt that that is what will happen this time around also. Finally, I would like to say that ironically, while the local economy is in pain this year, the external environment for India is probably the best ever. What India needs from the external world is low interest rates and low oil prices. And that is what is the current environment all about. And of course, add to that the shift of the urgent shift of manufacturing away from China that is likely because of the COVID experience and the breakdown of supply chains. So I think over time, the current very difficult situation should turn out to be positive for India. Let me stop here and I would request Mr. Krishnan to coordinate the question, please. Yes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Jain, for your candid views in terms of what the economy would look like and also getting into some specific sectors. So I would like, we have been getting a lot of questions. So people, I would request you to kindly put in your questions. Some of the questions that have come across on a general basis is on the stimulus that has been announced, and as a parallel question to that is the RBI's reforms that have happened. Do you think that this is enough, or do you think the government is going to come with more such measures in the near term?
See, I think the big package is behind us. That is what I feel. And as I mentioned, the resources with the government were limited because they have done big tax cuts over last few years already. I think RBI would continue to lower rates and they would continue to provide more liquidity support to the markets. I think once economy opens up, you will see that life will go back to normal fairly quickly, not on consumer discretionary, but in most other spheres. So I think the expectation of further fiscal stimulus, I would like to moderate that, except that interest rates, RBI will try to move them lower still, both at the short end and at the mid to long end.
So there's one sector that people are generally interested from the Gulf region is on the real estate sector. So what is, how do you view, I think both on the commercial side and on the residential side, how do you view this sector in the near term?
See, one, I am not an expert on real estate, but let me share with you some thoughts. I think work from home will become a reality. And I've been speaking to a few companies every day. And one CEO told me that they had been trying for work from home for 10 years. But there was a lot of resistance to change. But he said what we could not achieve in 10 years was achieved in 10 days. And I think even TCS has said that 75% of their employees will work from home by 2025. Google, Facebook are saying that a reasonable part of their workforces will work from home. So I think this is a new reality. And I think it could lead to lower demand for real estate. And I think what we are also seeing in India, given the very acute pain that retailers will face. See, a retail company operates on, they typically break even at 80% of sales. And the moment you lose 10, 20, 30% of sales, you are staring at a loss. So I think retailers, multiplexes, restaurants, even companies are asking for lower rents, and most landlords have no option but to oblige, because otherwise you will look at a vacancy. So I think the outlook for real estate, to my mind, is weak. And let us not forget that real estate before COVID also was in reasonable stress in India, both on the commercial, actually more on the residential side, because real estate prices in India in general have been less affordable. If you look at the world, the mortgage rates are actually lower or equal to the rental yields in many parts of the world. But in India, the mortgage rates were 3 to 4 times of the rental residential yields. However, one interesting thing is happening now is that the mortgage rates in India are now going to touch all-time lows. So I think 5 years back, the mortgage rates used to be 11 to 12%, and now we will be sub 7%. So in a short period of 5 years, the mortgage rates are down by half. So I think that will lead to higher volumes, but I think most of those volumes will come only in the budget to mid segments, because incomes at the top end are also significantly impacted. So in summary, I feel the outlook for real estate appreciation is not there, though volume should pick up in the low to mid income housing segments.
You've always been a vocal voice for the PSU banks in India. So given the sort of economic situation we are now faced in, how do you view the public sector banks' performance in terms of their being able to manage their profitability and other liquidity issues as well?
No, it is right, and it has actually been a mistake at my end, and it has caused considerable pain to us over the last few years. See, there are two sides to a bank's business. One is the liability side and one is the asset quality side. And last few years, the pain of NPAs was on the corporate side. And it took us almost 3 years to resolve this. And we were looking at current year as a year of normal profitability, not just for the public banks, but even for private corporate banks, let's say like ICICI or Axis, that had considerable pain of corporate NPAs. I think public banks are going to be probably less impacted along with other corporate banks. See, the one, their liability is extremely strong. I mean, if you heard SBI chairman last week, I think their deposits are growing 15%. Their deposit rates are the lowest, and they have got, I think, 1.5 lakh crores of extra deposits in a month. So there is a flight for safety given what has happened around Yes Bank, around smaller banks. So I think these banks, along with some strong private sector banks, are flush with liquidity, and the market share of deposits is consolidating with the stronger banks. So to that extent, they are better placed. I think the challenge is going to come, as I said, on the unsecured retail loans and on the MSME loans. I think the challenge will be felt more by the NBFCs and the retail loan focused banks. If you look at the public banks, the component of unsecured retail loans is close to zero. Their retail lending was mainly around mortgages and around automobile cars for salaried customers. But I think it would be naive to say that there will be no pain. So I think some pain will be there in the current year. But I think it will be far more for the retail focused. Environment has completely changed. Until 1 year back, we were talking of companies becoming NPAs. And now we are talking of individuals' loans turning into NPAs. So I think you have to keep that in mind.
Yes. Sure. Yeah, there are, two questions in one. One is your view on dollar rupee and on gold.
See, gold, I would not like to comment because it is a very, I have very poor knowledge of gold. And I look upon gold more as an insurance, that one should keep some money in gold from a long-term perspective. When everything around you is failing, gold will retain its value. I think as I said, in India, the external situation is actually very comfortable. You have $500 billion of reserves. You have the whole world which is keen to participate in India. Facebook writes a check of $10 billion for 10% stake or like that in the Jio. And I think, the foreign exchange reserves, the low oil prices, the low interest rates globally, I think they bode quite well for India. So I would say, but given the low interest rates in the world, surplus liquidity, gold may do well. I really don't have a view. On the rupee dollar, I think it should be stable. It should not depreciate much because the external situation of India is actually better post-COVID than pre-COVID.
Yeah, coming now to investment strategy, a lot of people are have raised questions in terms of now we are seeing the yields in the debt markets are have dropped considerably in the last few months. And now, how would somebody build portfolio on the debt side? And if one has to build a model portfolio going forward, what would be your recommendation in terms of how should investors be looking at investments at this point?
See, it will sound very, surprising to say this, but I think there are opportunities in Indian markets which I have seldom come across only once in 30 years, once before. So today we are in a very unique situation, and I would like to use the example of utility companies to drive home the point. See, what is a utility company? A utility company is a power generating or transmitting company which enters into 25-30 year contracts. So its ROE is the profitability is fixed for 25-30 years. Now, because of the fall in these markets and also because of the underperformance of these companies, we are in a situation where the dividend yield on these companies is higher than the bond yields, and sometimes it is as high as 2 times the bond yield. So I think equities in India, other than consumption, other than FMCG and consumer discretionary, I think it is offering good value to great value. And I think sectors like corporate banks, while there could still be some pain in the current year, but they are trading around one time book, a fraction of book. Utilities in India, the dividend yields are high single digits, low double digits, mid double digits. And these are companies which make $2-4 billion of profits. They are the strongest companies in the country. So I would say we have to live with low interest rates on the fixed income part. But to the extent it is possible, it is suitable, I think this would be a good time to invest in equities, because only once before have we seen a situation like this when dividend yields in non-cyclical, in very stable businesses are more than the bond yields. I would also like to add here is that the spreads of AA and single A papers in India are very high. And if someone wants to take advantage, you could. And that was because of the very specific situation around one mutual fund. And I think today it is possible to buy the bonds of large banks in India in high single digit kind of rates, and you could do that for AA and single A strong company as well. And I don't think that situation will last for very long.
So in terms of allocation, what would you say, sir? Whether large caps, mid caps, small caps, do we need to look into these, or how do you want to build ideal investor portfolio?
See, I have always been, said always that it is wrong to look at companies in terms of size. And growth is a function of the maturity of a business. It is not a function of its size. If you are making bearings or tires or batteries, and if someone is making cars, the car company is a large cap company, but the growth rates are linked. However, if you look at the sectoral distribution of small mid caps, in the small mid cap space, the key sectors are small banks, NBFCs, white goods, brown good companies, retail, multiplexes, malls, auto ancillaries. And I think these are segments which will be severely impacted. So given of the sectoral distribution of between small and large caps, I think my preference would be towards large cap companies at this point of time. Regarding asset allocation, I would say it is a very simple decision. I think India's economy will bounce back much faster. If you look at 9/11, if you look at Lehman, if you look at Brexit tapering, on every occasion when markets fell globally, Indian markets fell for 1 year. But 3 years from that day, there was a big gap between the returns in India and returns outside. Because of the underlying nature of this economy, it tends to bounce back extremely fast. See, only 10% of Indians have a car. And that tells you how much potential for growth is there in India. So I would say whatever portion of your money you don't need for the next 2, 3, 5 years, on whatever portion you can tolerate volatility, you should invest in equities. I would also like to say here that I have said the same thing 3 years back. I have said the same thing 5 years back. And today, if you look at the returns of Nifty over last 10 years, it is in single digits. So someone can say, is a 2 to 3 year time frame good enough? Because last 10 years, return Nifty are around 6-7%. So I think the right way to look at that is that when 10-year returns of Nifty in a fast-growing economy like India is in single digits, it is telling you the deep undervaluation, the 60% market cap to GDP that India is trading at, and only thrice before India has traded so low, and on each of those occasions, the returns over the next 3-5 years was extremely strong.
Thank you very much, Mr. Prashant Jain. And on that note, I take this opportunity to thank you for sparing your valuable time and being with us today. I think the questions are still flowing and it will go on and on. I think the sentiment has been what should be investors doing, and your thoughts in terms of stating that they should stay in for the long haul and the equities look as a good asset class in the near term as well. With this, I would now request our director, Mr. K.V. Shamsuddin, to formally propose a vote of thanks.
Mr. Prashant Jain and ladies and gentlemen, I express my sincere thanks to Mr. Prashant Jain for giving an insight of Indian capital market and a number of questions asked by more than 500 attendees presented today. In fact, you had given us a very clear picture of the current market scenario and the future of the market condition also. It gives all our investors a confidence how Indian market will behave in the future. We express our sincere thanks on behalf of Barjil Jojit Financial Service, as well as more than 500 guests attended today's webinar. In the future also, we will be organizing similar webinars for our investors, and our investors are giving a lot of support by participating in such a large number. One time I had seen more than 500 guests attended. So this webinar is giving a very good comfortable and convenient way of attending these kind of seminars and getting information about the market and how to make a decision and all. I once again, thanks to Mr. Prashant Jain for giving a wonderful presentation, and the future also, there will be more chances like this. I assure all our guests, in the coming weeks also, we will be having similar webinars. So we will keep on inform you all the functions we are planning. Thank you.
Thank you very much once again, Mr. Prashant Jain, Simal and Kabir for organizing this event, and wish you all Eid Mubarak. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Krishnan. Thank you, Barji.
Thank you, sir.
In the last 25 years, the returns on various financial asset classes like bank deposit, gold, and real estate have multiplied several times. But there are a few select investments in the Indian capital markets that have had the potential to appreciate exponentially over 100 times. If you had known this at the right time, you would have taken the right investment decision. which is precisely why you need an expert's validated advice when it comes to investing. Welcome to Barjeel, one of the few SEA-approved financial intermediaries in UAE. We are wealth builders, guiding customers since 2001. We have serviced over thousands of them till date, and today we cater to large segments across investor groups. This speaks about our enormous goodwill and their undiluted trust. And we have earned that trust by telling, not selling. We educate you on the investment opportunities that are ideal for you. We then help you make an informed decision, impartial and unbiased, keeping your long-term goals in mind. And with us, everything is long-term, be it commitment, relationships, or success. We offer comprehensive insights across a wide range of products through a holistic approach. We ask you the most important questions, the answers to which will help you focus on your investment objectives. For example, you work for over 30 years. Are you saving enough for the next 30 years? For life goals like children's education, your daughter's wedding, or your retirement. Think about it. You work hard to earn your money. Does your money work hard enough for you? Barjeel, let's build your future. Come, let's talk.